On Talking Lifestyle, The Weekender. Taking care of business every day. On Talking Lifestyle, Business Builders with David Koch. Thanks to Commander, the experts in business communication solutions. Demand a Commander and NAB, backing business in moments that matter.
Hello, good afternoon on this Sunday afternoon. Happy 2018 to you all. It's good to be back. Am I sounding convincing after a couple of weeks off lying on a beach? Well, hopefully you can feel and hear that positivity in my voice, because I reckon 2018 is going to be a cracker for not only the Australian economy, but for Australian small businesses as well. And of course, this is the program every Sunday and every Thursday afternoon on Talking Lifestyle, where we look after your small business. And in particular, we look after you as a small business person, how to make you more successful in 2018. And we do that by speaking to some great experts to give you the very best insight into business conditions and the economy going forward. And also, we like to inspire you as well with some terrific entrepreneurs who are doing great things, and we pick their brains and see if we can learn from them. And we've got a terrific family business that we're going to talk to this afternoon, Taylor's Wines. You probably tasted a bit of it over the Christmas New Year period, a stalwart of the Australian wine industry, which of course is one of our great exports. But Taylor's Wine started way back in 1969 and with just 400 acres, and now it is one of the great wine businesses, still family owned in Australia. Also, we're going to catch up with Dr. Suzy Green, who's a clinical and coaching psychologist, the founder of the Positivity Institute. All right. I don't know about you, but the end of last year, and if you're in a seasonal small business where summer and the Christmas period is your peak time, you're probably feeling a bit burnt out, maybe feeling a bit shackled to your business, maybe thinking, oh, is it all worth it to take on the stress and the regulation of running a small business? What's in it for me? Well, a lot of it is our mindset. And we want to kick you off in 2018 in the best possible mindset. So how to think more positive, how to be more positive in yourself. It was one of my New Year's resolutions. We've had the campaign for optimism over the last couple of months. I've got to continue. I'm going to step it up a notch in 2018 and tackle all the grumpy guts out there, all the negative thinkers, all the scaremongers, because it does nobody any good. And there are a lot of things that we should be grateful for at the moment, because things aren't as bad as it's portrayed, particularly on social media and in the media. So how to keep that positive frame of mind, because it will make your business more successful. If you're positive, your business will be more successful and your customers are going to be more likely to do business with you. So we're going to go through some steps on how you get that state of mind working for you with Dr. Suzy Green a bit later. But first up, first show for 2018. What's ahead of 2018 for your small business? You know, what's the economy looking like? What are some of the indicators that are coming through at the moment? So I thought we'd go straight to the gurus at ComSec. Senior economist Ryan Felsman joins me now. Ryan, happy new year to you.
Happy new year, Koshy.
Now, 2018, are you feeling positive?
Absolutely.
Why?
Sure am.
Why?
Well, we expect a continuation from 2017, and we saw a synchronized pickup, almost a Goldilocks scenario of global growth, benign inflation, low interest rates, fiscal stimulus and rising commodity and asset prices, Koshy. So we expect that to continue into 2018.
Well, that's terrific, because let's remind ourselves, Australia is on a record-breaking run at the moment, aren't we? 26 continuous years of positive economic growth. No other economy, first world economy in the world, has ever done that before. We never seem to acknowledge that, though, do we?
We don't, Koshy. So we're now into our 27th consecutive year, and that surpassed the previous record of uninterrupted growth achieved by the Netherlands. So in simple terms, Australia's performed well for some time now, supported by record low interest rates of 1.5%.
Okay. So let's talk about the big picture, the overall economy at the moment. Grew about 2.5% in 2017, a little below our 10-year average, but not by much. So sort of a normal growth. Do you expect it to stay there in 2018, or some of those indicators at the end of last year tended to indicate maybe it could be a bit better this year?
Koch, we expect a moderate improvement in economic growth in 2018 to about 3% in annual terms. And we're forecasting to obviously see unemployment rate potentially fall to around 5% by the end of 2018. It's currently at 4.5-year lows of 5.4%, but certainly we're seeing strong employment growth. Employment growth in 2017 was up by 3.2%. So that's certainly driving the economy at the moment, along with business investment, which has been very strong with business conditions near 20-year highs.
Because really, if you're a small business owner, you want an economy that's pretty stable, don't you? That's solid, stable, no surprises. So basically, you're saying that's going to continue, but our customers are going to find more work, and that's important.
That's absolutely right, Koshy. So what we've seen, of course, with strong employment, we've seen in the vicinity of around 380,000 jobs created over the last 12 months, and that's the biggest annual gain for 12 years. So that's providing consumers, customers in particular, with a lot of confidence in the economy, okay. Job security going forward.
Okay, hang on. All we read about is Holden being shut down, retrenchments everywhere, old school industries doing it tough and shedding staff. You're telling me 2017 was the best jobs growth in 12 years and you expect it to continue. So where are all the jobs being made?
In the services sector, Koshy. So the services sector is a growth engine of the Australian economy. So we've seen strong jobs growth, particularly in healthcare, construction, and even retail trade as well. So we had the job vacancies release for November, for the 3 months to November. We even saw manufacturing job advertisements or vacancies rise by 4,000. And that's despite the fact there was significant job losses in that sector during the year.
Hang on. Retail's dead, we're being told by a lot of parts of the media, that retail sales aren't as good as everyone thought. We've got Amazon coming in. It's a disaster. Faster, but we're still creating jobs. So
I kind of should mention that, Koshy, because we got the retail trade data for November and it was 1.2%, and that was the strongest outcome for a month in about 4 years.
Okay. So this is the thing that infuriates me, that so much attention is focused on the negativity. During the week, we had this report out saying Australia's obsession with credit card debt. You know, we binge on credit card debt. And I'm thinking, what the hell? Because during 2017, you and I, and with Craig Jones, were constantly talking about that credit card balances were at multi-year lows. They were shifting out of credit cards into debit cards. So in fact, bad debt, which is consumer debt, credit card debt, we're actually managing pretty well.
Absolutely. Koshy, Australians have been very conservative, very cautious, particularly after the global financial crisis, with credit card debt at decade lows. So balances are quite low at present, around $3,000, and from historical levels, that's very low. So still that caution continues.
Yeah, the caution. So a lot of these headlines that say we've got a dangerous passion for credit card debt are so off the mark, because I was reading some figures the other day saying of household debt in Australia, 92% of it you could class as good debt. Now, that's debt that's taken up to invest in a hopefully appreciating assets, which is generally the housing market. That's our mortgages, our biggest level of debt. Bad debt, credit card debt, consumer debt is only 8% of Australian household debt. By comparison, in the United States, that's 26% of their household debt. So Australians are actually pretty smart in handling debt, aren't they? Because
they are.
A lot of them are well ahead on their repayments on their home loan too.
That's absolutely right, Koshy. I mean, the number of credit cards is now falling in annual terms for the first time on record as well. So Australians learnt their lessons of the global financial crisis. Sure, mortgage debt remains fairly elevated, but of course those repayments are 30% less than they were in 2008. And that's largely due to the fact that interest rates are at record lows.
Yeah, so we're pretty smart. So the scaremongering on this report that came out, and I read the report and thought, this is so naive, it's ridiculous. Really, once again, focuses on the negativity rather than the positive side. Now, one thing that has affected Australians in 2017 is that we're sort of asset rich and cash poor, aren't we? Our wealth is going up and it's at record levels. I think we're the average Australian is the second wealthiest in the world behind the Swiss, but it doesn't feel like it because our wages growth hasn't been there. It's only been around 1.5%. Do you think that wages growth, more cash in our pocket because you can't eat your house value or your superannuation, will wages growth start to pick up in 2018?
We think so, Koshy. I mean, obviously wages growth has been at record low levels of about 1.9%. It's picked up just to 2% recently, and that's despite the fact we've seen strong employment growth. So this disconnection at present between strong employment growth and wages growth, and that's largely on the back of technological disruption, an ageing population, of course, and an increased casualisation of the workforce. So those forces are at play, but generally what you see with strong employment growth is emerging vacancies, particularly in skilled areas. And as a consequence of that, that generally leads to rising wages in those industries in particular. So we expect that elusive wages growth to gradually pick up. It'll be slow, probably up to about 2.25% this year, and that should boost underlying inflation above 2%. It's currently at 1.8%.
Okay. Interest rates on hold for the foreseeable future?
We think interest rates will be on hold until the end of the year. We need to see evidence of that wages growth first before we think the Reserve Bank will move. But certainly, if you look at some of the underlying sectors of the economy, particularly the business sector, business investment rose by 7.8% last year, especially infrastructure spending by the government, which increased by 13%. Yeah. Those sectors in particular providing a lot of support for the Australian economy at the moment. So all we need is that inflation to pick up, Koshy, and we should see interest rates rise, but very, very slowly.
That's great.
Low levels.
Ryan, great to catch up. Happy New Year to you. Have a great 2018. We'll catch up regularly. Ryan Felsman there from ComSec. There you go. What do we need to run our small business? We want no surprises from the government. We want no surprises from the economy. Steady as she goes. We want low unemployment and low inflation rates. We basically got it in 2017. It's going to happen in 2018. Which is a great environment for us to run our small businesses, because then it's up to us to make sure we control the success of our business. And that's what we do here on Business Builders every Sunday afternoon. We'll be back with some inspiration after the break. Welcome back to Business Builders. It's our first Sunday back for 2018. It's great to have your company as you start to, a lot of people start to focus on going back to work tomorrow, as I am on Sunrise. So I've got to get rid of the old holiday beard because I don't think they'll like that turning up. But hey, over the Christmas New Year period, I don't know whether you're the same as me, but we tend to partake in a lot of good old Australian wines. And the wine industry here in Australia is one of our biggest exporters. It is a wonderful industry because it goes from growing the stuff to processing it, to packaging it and exporting. It's one of those few industries where the whole process is done here in Australia, and it really adds value to those export dollars. And there are so many great stories in that industry as well that have started, and good small business family stories. And a lot of ideas come from around the kitchen tables in the garage and a few bevvies. Our next guest and his family made their business all around wine. In 1969, Taylor family purchased land in the beautiful Clare Valley in South Australia, great part of the world, planting up to 400 acres of Cabernet and Shiraz grapes in hope that their dream to be one of the best Australian wine companies would come true. Well, three generations on, Taylors are still operating. And joining us today, Managing Director and third generation winemaker Mitchell Taylor, joining us and interrupting his holidays to inspire us this afternoon. Mitchell, thanks for your time.
Pleasure.
Happy New Year to you. 40 years as a family business. What's been the secret to that success?
I think the secret to the success has been sharing the family passion for making quality wines. Also realising that, you know, the wine industry is a fabulous industry, but it's a bloody difficult industry.
Yeah.
There are a lot of wine ricks out there. There are a lot of great new ideas. And I think it's being humble and learning from your failures, but turning the failures or the early times in the business where we nearly went bankrupt or we nearly lost things, but turning them into passionate folk stories about what makes us successful.
What did you learn from those failures when you look back?
One big one was when we planted all the Cabernet Sauvignon and the Shiraz. It was the largest planting in the Southern Hemisphere in the late 70s, was all of a sudden the fashion at the time, everyone was saying, oh, we're not sure about the histamines in red wine. And so we had quite a few vintages that we could not sell. And I'll always remember my old man Bill say, just remember, son, you know, as we got close to bankruptcy and we had to graft, we had to go through and cut half the vineyard out and transfer it over to white varieties of Riesling and this new exotic thing called Chardonnay that had just hit Australia. But I'll always remember he said to me, just remember, son, we're not in the wine business, we're in the fashion business. And that was something that we always had to be preoccupied with, making sure that we were in touch with the market. And my granddad was an old publican, so he had pubs before, and he was always used to talking to the customers. And that was another thing we learned, you know, being in the wine industry. While as winemakers, we love our passion and we love making the best wines, we've always got to make sure we're making wines that our customers will love.
Because just in recent years, like the last 10 years, the industry has gone through a massive oversupply, hasn't it? As wine became very trendy, it was consumed, the global financial crisis hit, wine sales dropped, there was a massive increase in supply. How did you survive that?
Yeah, that is very difficult. It's like a perfect storm that happens.
Yep.
Because we have such long cycles and that it takes the vines about 4 to 5 years to be planted and to bring the new fruit on, you actually got to predict what people will be enjoying, you know, 4 or 5 years out. So when it comes to the family business, you've got to be extremely long-sighted, you've got to be strategic, and you've got to have what we call patient capital. So in other words, when we make decisions on are we going to plant Shiraz or we're going to plant Chardonnay, we're sort of talking about decisions that will hopefully add value to the business in 5 to 10 years' time.
As a family, how do you make those decisions? How do you work out who the decision makers are? Sort of who makes up Taylor's Wines?
Well, what we have is we have various elements where we communicate about, you know, what the family issues are with the business, and we have what we call a family council and a family constitution that just professionalises things a bit so that we're not, you know, hiding secrets from each other. We're sort of putting them down on paper, and then we talk through all the issues and flesh them out, and then, you know, we run it as you know, as the business has grown, it's become bigger and bigger. And as it becomes bigger, you've just got to put little professional things in. So we've now, you know, we used to just talk around the kitchen table in the early days, where now, you know, I've had to get my old man used to talking with my brothers and other members of the family around the board table. And we actually now bring in independent directors that understand the wine industry. So they just keep us all on track and make sure that, you know, the business is sound and that we're communicating properly as a family.
Well, that's a great lesson to a lot of family businesses, isn't it? You can't do it around the kitchen table. It's got to be formal. There's got to be accountability, and that keeps the arguments down and everyone happy. There's complete transparency.
Yeah, exactly. And the different roles, like I'm the managing director and a winemaker, but all of us have different skills and different areas. Like, you know, my brother's good at selling and another's really good at, you know, the marketing side of things. And that really helps is that you leverage the skill base off others, but you also have a team where you create not only family members, but non-family members have the same family values in regards to how the business operates.
Yep.
So it works well.
The export market, obviously massive for the Australian wine industry and China in particular. How have you developed that side of it?
Yeah, that's a great challenge for us at the moment. We've just started. We've been there for about 15 years and been steadily moving well. And we're now have a new agent, and we've just employed a Chinese person that lives up in that part of the world. So we work with building that relationship, and the Chinese have respect for long-term family businesses. They really like that because that's a lot of the philosophy that they have in their own businesses.
Yep.
And the other thing that they're very interested in is high-quality Australian red wine.
Mm.
And as a category, the Australian red wines now are growing at a faster rate than the French, and we will soon become the number one exported country into that very exciting market. So it's growing at about 40% at the moment for the industry. And with us, what we're doing is talking up our qualities. Like, we've just been ranked number one winery in the world. So that was a great accolade, not only for our little business, but the first time an Australian winery had it. And now we're in the process of communicating that to the Chinese. And they want something that is pure, authentic, and really, you know, is not just, you know, made up and artificial. So, you know, that's the positive on that front.
Oh, yeah. And the size and the numbers are just massive for everyone up there. Look, Mitchell, thank you so much for joining us and sharing your wisdom this afternoon and breaking into your holiday up there in Byron Bay. Really appreciate it. Good luck for 2018.
Looking forward to a great vintage. Thanks, Koshy, and all the best with getting back to work.
Thanks for that. Yeah, it's got to be I may need a bit of a tipple of Taylor's Wines to help me along, I reckon. Mitchell Taylor there, the Managing Director of Taylor's Wines. Taking a love there. We're not in the wine business. We're in the fashion business. It's absolutely right. You're listening to Business Builders. Welcome back to Business Builders on this Sunday afternoon. Now, starting a new year is a time to re-energise, re-engineer yourself and your business. Joining our campaign for optimism this year is Dr. Suzy Green, clinical and coaching psychologist and founder of the Positivity Institute. Welcome to the program, Dr. Suzy. Great to have you aboard. And you've got some great advice today for business owners on how the science of optimism can reignite your business. Now, what exactly, how do you define optimism?
Oh, hi, David. Yes. Well, there's actually quite a lot of research, scientifically speaking, on optimism. And generally, we know that there are two types of optimism. One is what most people understand optimism to be, which we refer to as dispositional. So the people that either see the glass, you know, half full or half empty. But there's also another type that's been identified in the research that concerns how we explain when bad things happen, so when adversity strikes. And we find that the optimists tend to see it as not, you know, something that they've created themselves personally. It's not something that's going to last permanently a long time, and it's not pervasive. It's not going to affect everything. Whereas the pessimists really blame themselves when bad things happen. Mm. They think it's going to last forever, and they think it's affecting everything in their lives. And those types of mindsets have been shown scientifically to affect our mood, even to the point of creating levels of depression, and obviously then affect our behaviour.
Yep. And also, particularly if you're a small business owner, if you're a pessimist, you shouldn't be in small business, should you? You've got to be an optimism because your staff feed off you and also your customers feed off you. It's just bad business to be pessimistic.
Oh, so true. And there's been quite a lot of research and studies done on entrepreneurship as well, and no surprises here, but generally the ones that are you know, doing well have high levels of optimism. And you're also absolutely right. There's some really interesting research coming out now using social network analysis to actually map out these energy networks in the workplace. And what most of us have known that, you know, that we emotions are contagious. Most of us know that from that negativity or that pessimism, but we also know that positive emotions are contagious. So you can create this ripple effect. So, I mean, no pressure on the business owner, but it is something to be aware of.
Okay. So if you're the business owner, how do you, and say you're a bit burnt out, you're getting a bit negative about your business, you feel, you know, you keep questioning, is it worth the hassle, is it worth the stress, particularly if you've had a tough 2017 and you're wondering whether it's all worth it. How do you turn yourself around? How do you become more positive yourself to give it the best shot?
Yeah, and you know what? Some of us are naturally good at that, and I guess they'll be sitting here listening going, I don't find that difficult at all. But you're absolutely right too. There are many people that really struggle with that. And we also know that when you get, say, you know, a number of things that are starting to go wrong, and also once we have one thing happen, we tend to notice more of the bad, if you like, and we get into this downward spiral really easily. So it's actually a skill. Learning to, I guess, be mindful of our, we call them the ants, the automatic negative thoughts. And we all have them, but when you really get into that negative space, it's like, well, some of my clients in the past have said they have ant farms. So many ants. So, and these skills are now starting to be taught in schools, thankfully. Not all schools yet, but kids are starting to learn this concept of mindset, and that just because we have a thought, it doesn't necessarily mean it's a fact. And how do we become like little scientists, if you like, or detectives? Really questioning our mindset. Is it rational? And even if it is rational, is it helpful? And how can I think differently that's going to help me feel perhaps not ecstatic about the reality of the situation, but more hopeful? And then is it going to motivate me to proactively engage in behaviours?
See, when I get a bit pessimistic on something, or I get stressed or whatever, or I've got a whole bunch of different ants, as you talk about, I go, right, don't stress over it. Let's take one ant at a time and I have a plan to work through it. And, you know, once you start focusing on the problem and the solution, it automatically de-stresses you and makes you more optimistic.
That's right. And I guess sometimes the natural tendency is to stick your head in the sand, particularly when things are starting to spiral. But you're, again, being able to face it, break it down. Sometimes we'll often recommend that you actually write the ants down, because when they're in your head, you feel them to be truths. Yep. When you put them down on paper and you look at it and you go, that's ridiculous. How could I be thinking that? So when you're learning this as a skill, if you're not a natural at this mindset shift, if you like, write it down on paper, ask yourself some questions around, is it rational? How is it helpful? What would I say to my best friend if they were having a thought like this? Because often it's so easy to challenge your friends, Anne, but it's very hard to do it for yourself.
Yep, absolutely. Dr. Suzy Green, some great advice to kick off 2018. We'll talk regularly throughout the year if we can. Really appreciate your time.
Fantastic, David. Thanks for having me on the show.
Dr. Suzy Green there from the Positivity Institute. So important. That's what the Campaign for Optimism is all about. When you get a grumpy guts, come and whinge to you. I always say, hang on, what are you whingy about? You know, the average Australian is the second wealthiest in the world. We have low unemployment. We've got a world record-breaking run of positive economic growth. We have best business conditions in 9.5 years. Come on, buck yourself up. If we keep saying that around the barbecues and to customers and to colleagues, well, then we can turn everything positive. Coming towards the end of the show, let's finish off with questions from you. In Ask Koshy, don't forget you can email them through to Talking Lifestyle. Gary says, do you know if you have contractors or freelancers who invoice you themselves if you're required to pay their superannuation, or is it up to them to do this? I've heard mixed things. Any advice you could give would be great. Well, Gary, my understanding, check this with your accountant or bookkeeper first, is that if it's a freelancer invoicing you direct, and particularly if they have their own ABN or their own company, then they have to pay their own super. They're responsible for their own superannuation because they're a separate entity. You're not just dealing with an individual, you're dealing with a corporate entity who has an ABN, who pays their GST, who's got to put their BAS in, all that sort of stuff. So it's up to their obligation. Their organisation does it. So you look after your own superannuation and that of your own staff. Hey, where should you get information like this? One of my favourite, and I'm going to sound a real nerd here, one of my favourite websites is the tax office website, would you believe, ato.gov.au. A wealth of information and answers to questions like this. Also, they have some great resource centres at the ATO website too, which allows you to qualify deductions and all that sort of stuff. That's really good. Also, business enterprise centres can be a great stopping off point for any questions and any information like this as well. So a couple of good sources there. Thanks for your question, Gary. Don't forget, we'll answer more of your questions next Sunday afternoon. You have a great rest of the weekend. If you're going back to work like me tomorrow morning, good luck. Come on, be bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, and be positive in 2018.